Hello, I'm Sheryl McCarthy. Welcome to One to One. Gentrification, the process through which poor urban neighborhoods change as wealthier people move in, housing is improved, new business is attracted, and current residents are displaced. It's been going on as long as there have been poor urban areas. However, in their book, What the Signs Say, Language, Gentrification, and Placemaking in Brooklyn, John Jay College professors Shonna Trinch and Edward Snajdr look at gentrification through a new lens by observing how the signs on retail stores change over time. They discovered that the signs not only reflected the gentrification that is taking place, they helped move the process along, and sometimes they caused trouble. What the Signs Say is published by Vanderbilt University Press. Welcome.
Thank you.
A 300-page book about store signs, which sounds like a kind of odd subject to pursue. What got you interested in this?
Well, when we moved to Brooklyn, I was amazed by how many words I saw in our commercial districts. And Ed came home from class one day, and he told me that he had mentioned to his students that Brooklyn was the kind of place where people crammed as many words as possible in a storefront sign. So he'd articulated my feeling, and that really set us out on this project where we started photographing storefront signs in Brooklyn. And we photographed something between 2,000 and 3,000 photos. We can't stop taking photographs, so we're still doing that. But that's what got us started on looking at storefront signs.
And what were you hoping to find out?
Looking at the landscape and looking at what we were seeing in the retail environment, it also became apparent that there were two different types of signs. And what we called old school, and what my students actually told me, hey, that's old school, when I told them about these wordy signs, which they laughed and understood. You know, as an anthropologist, Sean as a linguist, we recognized that we had touched on something that was emic. In other words, from the native's point of view, from residents' point of view, and from a local cultural experience. And we knew that this type of wordy signage that we were seeing was something significant and something very much linked to the Brooklyn aesthetic. But we also noticed in neighborhoods very different signs that had very little words on them. And also it was kind of hard to tell what the stores were selling. And as we started to take a look at all of our photo data, we realized that we were definitely seeing two patterns. And the old school signage we recognized as something that was actually very inclusive. And we detail this in the book as to what those features are linguistically and how they operate to be inclusive and to represent the diversity of Brooklyn in a very equitable way.
So the old school signs, these were the signs that had been there for a while. By stores that had been there for a while, correct?
That's right. Pre-gentrification signs, yes.
Okay. And what were the, could you describe, you said they have a lot of words in them. What other things, what characteristics of the old school signs?
Yeah. So when we sat down to do an analysis, we found that they were multilingual. We found that they made very sincere references to what anthropologists and linguists call cultural categories, such as race, class, ethnicity, national origin. We found that they were reiterative. They told you what they had inside in long lists and sometimes repeated over and over again. So as we read them, we started to get this message that there was this, make no mistake, we have something for you. No matter who you are, we want to sell you our products. So you would have things like buns and bagels, right? So different types of bread for different types of people, possibly. There was a synergism between groups, like Mexican and Chinese food, or Spanish and American food. So there was kind of always this idea that, like, we're here to serve all kinds of different groups all the time. And we're telling you exactly who we are.
Some of them had spelling errors in them, correct?
That was also a really big finding and an important finding, because what we found was that there was no system, linguistic system of domination, that there was an inclusiveness with language that said that no one should consider one way of writing or one way of speaking any better than any other, right? Which was really important, I think, a very important finding.
Okay, so those were the old school signs. Ed, what were the characteristics of the new school signs?
Well, it is interesting because when we examined it, we saw very clear patterns and very clear characteristics. So, for example, there was maybe one or two words on a sign. The font size of the text was very small. Often signs had languages other than English with no English on it. And the type of use of that language was to invoke a kind of an exoticness. There was also a lot of wordplay. And so what we call polysemous terms, words with more than one meaning or interpretation. And in that sense, we saw how those characteristics kind of always presented together on these new, what we call new school signs, which definitely were representations of newer businesses, more upscale businesses, and clearly kind of a marker of a gentrifying process.
So the old school signs said, everybody's welcome here. What was the message that the new school signs gave out?
Well, I'll just say that we kind of struggled with this in interpreting what it was that they were saying. Some reviewers of our work as it was being written told us that these new school signs were in fact more thoughtful, that a lot of thought went into them. But we found them to be actually quite thoughtless and not really caring about who was around. Cryptic, and I would say we were dealing with the idea of exclusivity and distinctiveness. But in the end, a lot of our informants simply said they felt excluded. And so they were exclusionary.
Some examples of some of the new school signs, because it seemed like some of them presented a sort of a puzzle. You're supposed to figure out what we're here for, what we sell.
Right, and especially in the context of old school signs, which were incredibly explicit about what they did and who they were, these new school signs were just the opposite, right? They were ambiguous. And so as we tried to analyze these signs for possible meanings, again, we got some criticism that said, well, how do you know what the shopkeeper meant? And we said, well, that's precisely the point. Whatever they mean to be ambiguous, which is very different in a context of multi-everything. And it can be very off-putting to people who have felt discriminated against, people who have not always felt accepted in places, to now have to solve a puzzle about what's possibly in a store. When we asked people, what do you think of these signs? They said that they felt excluded, that they were exclusionary, that you had to be part of a club to be invited in. And of course, you know, we're not saying that the store owners meant this, but this was the message that was being stated.
Give me some examples of some of these signs and what they seem to signify.
So one of the signs that we talk about is a restaurant called James. It's a brown awning with one word on it that says James. And no one, you know, people said they had no idea what was going on in there. Then there was another.
What was going on? What was going on in there?
It was a restaurant. It was an expensive restaurant. And we do want to point out too, that a lot of the old school stores, they weren't necessarily for low income people all the time. I mean, that was also one of the misconceptions that people said, well, you know, the new school is upscale, but we found storefronts with hundreds of words on them, or not that many, but dozens of words on them, that had $9,000 chandeliers inside of them. So it's not that old school signage was not reaching out to different socioeconomic groups. They were, but they were doing just that, reaching out to all different groups. Whereas the new school signs typically almost every time were at a higher price point.
You had a garden store called Dig. How do you analyze that? What does that signify, and what kind of message does that give? And to whom?
One of the things that we find in the new school signage is that it puts hierarchies on the land in Brooklyn a place where we didn't see hierarchy before in the old school signage, right? The old school signage, like we said, made really sincere references to race and class and ethnicity and all of these other things. And by sincere, we mean that people would say, this is a Catholic store. Come in and buy stuff if you're Catholic, right? So people would say, well, that excludes, you know, Muslims or Jewish people, but we didn't read it like that. We read it as we're holding place for ourselves and for you and for difference, right? We don't have to obliterate difference here or pretend that we're all secular. We can have difference and that's okay in old school Brooklyn. In new school Brooklyn, we see just the opposite. No holding of place for difference. And when people of different cultural categories are being referenced, it's also often ironic. So we see dig as an ironic use of a potential African-Americanism, right? To dig, right? It's a very old school African-Americanism that has been, you know, definitely become part of standard English as well. But in a place like Atlantic Avenue, where so many, you know, African-American people have been displaced in the middle of this gentrification process, we started to analyze this word and look it up, and it had like 17 different definitions, one of which was to jibe or to jeer. So it seemed to be mocking the entire process of gentrification and displacement, and then also, you know, having this coy term of gardening at the same time, right? So people could always say, well, that's not what we meant. Right, but it is a potential meaning. And we did find that people found it to be offensive.
So you have, they use a kind of what you think of as an old school term, do you dig this? But right. You're using it for a new school meaning. I mean, when you say dig to me, I think of, first of all, I think of an archaeological dig, mm-hmm. but then it's really a garden store,
exactly.
You know? So it could have a lot, as you said, a lot of different kinds of meanings. One, there was another garden store called Botanica, and yes. That certainly evokes a lot of different meanings as well, right?
For sure, for sure. It has a Latinate, you know, meaning to it. Botanica comes from Latin, and it means plants and herbs and all of that. And then, you know, the Latinx community in Brooklyn has old school storefronts that are called Botanicas, which sell religious relics, different types of kind of homeopathic remedies for different illnesses. And then here comes this garden store that again is selling very high priced plants that is again co-opted this term.
Ed, one thing that you write in the book is that sometimes the old school signs change as the neighborhood becomes more gentrified. Tell me about that.
Yes, that's correct, Sheryl. The features of old school are so incredibly open that one of the things that we saw happening with them is that as new residents came in, gentrifiers, if you will, some stores started to add things on their signage that would clearly appeal to that population. And an example of that would be the word organic.
Oh, yeah.
Operating that into, you know, an old school bodega, you know, made sense. So we analyzed the old school type as being very open to everything. And it's a reinforcement of that multicultural sensibility and very basic kind of linguistic projection of the idea of diversity.
Shonna, you suggested that new school signs can sometimes be interpreted as being disrespectful of long-term residents. And perhaps an example of this, perhaps not. There was a maternity store called Baby Mama. Yeah. Tell me how that's supposed to, the messages that sends.
Yeah, well, so Baby Mama is one of the most egregious examples, perhaps, of this kind of co-opting of African-American terminology and misusing it. You know, we had to investigate what this term meant, and it meant for many people in the African-American community, it is not a term that gets thrown around lightly. It is somewhat derogatory. It is not supposed to be used in mixed company in a lot of with a lot of people in the community. And in Bay Ridge, we found this store, and it was a high-priced mother and baby store that sold mostly to white women and their babies. And when we did ask one of the store owners about the racial overtones to the name, they suggested that that was not their intention, that they were just, they really loved Tina Fey. And Tina Fey has a movie where she also uses the term. And we also analyze the use of the term in Fey's movie as, again, racist, right? I mean, it is using in a very indirect way this terminology to poke fun at a community that has used this term to indicate struggle and right. to indicate a very difficult situation for people in the community. So again, this is when Ed says thoughtless, right? I mean, it looks cute and coy and some people might think that's clever, but it's also very thoughtless. And when we brought this up to our African-American informants, some of them like moved back as if they were being hit in the face. Like, who does that? Who would put that on a storefront sign?
Talking about thoughtless, I think one big example of a new store owner who was considered thoughtless. This is with the Summerhill store. Not so much the title of the store, but the way it was being promoted. So tell me about that.
So this is a case that we address much later in the book. And and just to clarify, our book is not just about the storefront signs. That kind of opens the question to what is being presented and what are the symbols and what are the messages.
Of gentrification
right. and how it operates. And more importantly, I think it's really an homage to the old school model, which does define Brooklyn historically. But Summerhill was a case where the owner was kind of capitalizing off of a history of violent experiences and in a way that was not sincere. And there were holes in the back of-
This is a restaurant.
It's a restaurant in Crown Heights, yes. And it on the back of the shop were bolt holes from shelving. Somebody somewhere said, oh, well, you know, those look like bullet holes. And then the owner, Becca Brennan, put out a press release as she was opening the store that indicated that those were real bullet holes and that she was keeping them as part of the aesthetic of the new business. And people heard about it. One of our informants actually started a movement to have a public conversation about it and to maybe demonstrate against this shop and request an apology on the part of the owner. What we do then in that chapter is show you how she never really apologizes. And Shonna did a lot of work there as a linguist, looking at the different ways that she uses privilege and never gives up that privilege in very public interactions with people in the neighborhood, in the community, with customers, et cetera. And it's a really telling, when you read through it, you definitely see the steps that people take to not give any ground. And that case is was public and was written about in the press in a very prominent way. But
it was really pretty tone deaf to the concerns of the people in the community. And there was also not only the faux bullet holes that I'm gonna keep to keep this place authentic, but she also had on the menu a 40-ounce rosé.
Malt liquor or beer right. in 40-ounce bottles,
right.
which
right.
the implication is people would put it in a brown bag because in public space, you know, you're being private, right?
Right.
And then it was mocked and used to kind of sell wine. So her target audience, target customer, was not in any way someone who would drink a 40-ounce, you know, bottle of beer.
Right.
Tone deaf is a really good characterization of the owner's movements and speech. Yet I think it's a little more than that, in the sense that in analyzing her interaction with people, there also was a real reluctance to give up that privilege of feeling that they are right, they can do whatever they would like because they are the ones who are making choices. So there's a thoughtlessness in that, which we connect to other places and cases in that chapter. For example, the naming of a street in Brooklyn after Christopher Wallace, the Biggie Smalls, the rapper, and the resistance of gentrifiers in that neighborhood against such a move based on his character, not necessarily his real connection with the community, as well as other cases where people try kind of thoughtlessly to appropriate terminology and institutions in a Brooklyn setting like the bodega. There was right. a business that tried to open up a vending operation and they called it bodega, and again, tone deaf, and met with a lot of backlash from people who know bodegas and their significance.
There was another store, I guess it was another maternity store that had an interesting name. I never would have figured out what it was, called Boing Boing. What was that all about?
Boing Boing was one of the first, one of the first stores that in Park Slope that catered to mothers and babies. And we talk about, women in the city as being really important in changing kind of in changing public space, making it a place for women and children, where cities have historically been thought of as very male dominated spaces, spaces where men could move about freely and women needed to have more safety measures put in place. And so Boing Boing was really interesting because it put out on the sign that there are women who have children and will nurse them. And so that was the old school incantation of Boing Boing, which then updated to actually put on their sign at your service. Since 1996 or whenever it opened. So we did an analysis of how some of these new school signage did seem to be changing something with respect to women, pregnancy, these topics that were supposed to be taboo and hush-hush, and brought them out into the public.
I'm looking at something that you wrote about Boing Boing, and you wrote that, quote, "This open display of women's sexuality and political power to claim urban space both transforms women's private individual reproductive roles by making women as mothers public at the same time that it creates public space for them in Brooklyn." That's a really deep analysis of this sign, right?
Yeah, it is. It is. And I think that, you know, when you start mentioning women's private parts on signs, you know, something is going on.
Something has changed, right.
Something is changing. And we found other evidence of that, you know, through in the press, where there was this real backlash against these women who would go out in public and nurse their babies. And they were being written up in the New York Times as being unseemly characters who you know, were stepping out of line and doing things that people didn't think were appropriate. The references to stroller Nazis, you know, so you saw that there was this suggestion that these women are not in their place. And that was really interesting to us. And the storefronts, some of them were also suggesting that.
Probably decided it is. It's a sort of white, upper middle class women are coming in and they're kind of with their strollers and their babies are taking over our neighborhood. Is that?
I think that there was, I think that was the suggestion, though, you know, that criticism wasn't necessarily coming from communities of color. It was coming from, the mainstream press,
right.
often quoting, you know, white men who were making these claims.
Who is your book meant for, and what do you want people to take from it? And what do you think are the lessons that you learn that need to be addressed as more neighborhoods become gentrified? And you've got a total of 2 minutes to answer all those questions.
Well, that's a really great question. And I think that, you know, Ed touched on it in the beginning. Old school Brooklyn was a really inclusive place. It wasn't perfect. It wasn't a utopia. We're not suggesting that at all. But it was a place where a lot of different people got together and got to maintain difference and coexist. And while that wasn't always peaceful, it is remarkably peaceful when you think about how much difference there is. The gentrifiers are coming in and we're not making place for everybody. And if we want a city where we can make place for everybody, we're gonna have to intervene in the process. So that's one thing to take away. And the other thing is that, sure, this is a free country and you can say whatever you want, but be sure and rest assured as well that people will talk back and they have a right to do so. They have a right to say when you're being thoughtless and we all have a lot to learn in terms of other people's experiences. So we should try to be open to that learning process.
As you said earlier, it's not just a book about signs. It's about gentrification and the various different kinds of conflicts that can create. And, you know, signs are just a part of that. Very interesting concept, one that a lot of people had not thought about before. Very interesting. I learned some stuff.
Thank you so much.
Unfortunately, we're out of time. I want to thank professors Shonna Trinch and Edward Snajdr, professors at John Jay College, for joining me today. Their book, What the Signs Say, Language, Gentrification, and Placemaking in Brooklyn, is published by Vanderbilt University Press. Also, to learn about our upcoming shows, be sure to follow us on Twitter at 1to1 CUNY TV for the City University of New York and 1to1. I'm Sheryl McCarthy.